Hello everyone, thank you all for joining in today. On behalf of Art and Artisans Group India, I'd like to welcome our guest speaker, Saurabh Desai. Saurabh Desai's passion of becoming a nature photographer encouraged him to choose his freedom to thrive as an artist over his professional career as an engineer. His journey of creating images that commenced from his balcony continues through deep forests, soundless runs, endless grasslands, passing through strident coastal lines and colossal wetlands up to the snowy peaks of Himalayas. Colors, patterns, intensity, minimalism, peace, flow, monochromes, depicting sentimental values, etc. are his subjects now. His choice of fine art form of nature photography has provided him the satisfaction as a preservationist of nature in a creative manner, where any general nature loveliness has become his subject, irrespective of its common appearances. So here I present Saurabh Desai. Thank you so much, sir, for being here with us.
So hello everyone. Thanks for joining on Sunday, because Sundays are very precious. Because weekend and everybody has their own plan, but it's good that you are, you know, sparing some time to talk about art on Sunday evening. So guys, I'll straight away go to my presentation, and today we are going to talk about creativity and fine arts in nature photography, because I hope everybody is aware of photography and the different genres and how people are taking up nowadays and how it has gone to next level since when the digital era of photography has come. And you know, so what we are to talk about today is not, it has not thing to do with technical details. It has nothing to do with how to take pictures and, you know, how you go to the forest and how you pick up your subjects and all. It is more about the philosophy behind creating an art piece out of nature. It is creating an art piece through what is there in front of you when you go to the places which are into the wild, right? So I'll just share my screen and then I'll start my presentation, and here we go. So today's topic that we have picked up is art of seeing as nature photographer. It is very important that as a photographer, we need to know how it is not about how we capture the things or what we capture. I think it is more about how we see the things as a photographer. So whenever I present my work, I present my work as visual poetries. They are the poetries in pictures. So when I say it's visual poetries, because I want my viewers to understand and elaborate my work the way they want it and not the way I want to present it to them. So I want to give that freedom to all my viewers to understand my work according to their perception of art and not how I have seen it or, you know, I have captured it. So it is more important that today what we are to talk about is more philosophical, it is more emotional than the technical things. So guys, just to give you a very small brief about my history as a person, because by mistake I'm a mechanical engineer, and after studying mechanical engineering in 2012, I decided to become a full-time photographer. But I had been doing photography from 1997, so it's been more than 20 years that I have been doing photography. But meanwhile, I had to pursue my mechanical engineer, and I got into Larsen and Toubro L&T. And I worked there for around 7.5 years. And after 7 years, I just wanted to live my life as an artist. And I left my job in 2012. And today I've been running a company called 50mm Media Production and Visual Poetries. Right. So that's the brief about myself. So guys, we'll straight get into the wildlife and nature photography. That, you know, there are a lot of purpose. It's initially, a lot of people used to do nature photography. A lot of people used to do wildlife photography from the perspective of a journalist, from the perspective of researcher. From the perspective of journalist and researcher, when they see the nature. Somebody's mic is on. Please. Yeah. Hello. So when you see wildlife and nature from the perspective of journalist or from the perspective of naturalist, they tend to make images which are more informative. like what we see in National Geographic, what we see in Discovery, Animal Planet, that every image and every footage that they are showing us, it used to give us information. But there were very few photographers who used to make artistic images out of wildlife. I'm talking about the initial days. So what are the purposes of making images in nature and wildlife photography? So the hobby is one of the reasons that people do wildlife photography. Research and study, of course, is one of the major chunk of photographers. They are doing their images. They are making their images for research and study. Documentation, somebody is doing it for conservation. For a lot of people, it is an adventure trip. For a lot of youngsters nowadays, it's a passion kind of thing. It's for a very few people, it is a profession. For a lot of people like me, it is my identity, lifestyle. A lot of people nowadays are getting into wildlife photography because of social media and, you know, to post pictures and just to get into that number games and all. And the last but not the least, the people like me, we do nature and wildlife photography to create art out of it. So out of all these reasons, of course, I do photography for conservation. I make pictures as documents. I make pictures for research and study. But the major interest of making images into wildlife and nature is to create an art piece out of it, right? So we are not going to talk about rest of the reasons why we do photography, but we are going to talk about why we are doing photography as an art. So when it comes to wildlife photography, and a lot of people, when they have, I'm talking to the layman, I'm talking to people in general. When you say someone that I'm a wildlife and nature photographer, their basic instinct, their basic perception is, oh, you are clicking lions or maybe tigers or sometimes leopards or maybe cheetahs. So this is the basic impression of wildlife photography, lion, tiger, leopard, all the big cats, which looks quite fascinating for a lot of people. And this used to be the general identity of wildlife photography. The nature photography word did not exist initially when it came to photography. So this was the general identity of wildlife photography, that these kind of big animals are very, you know, they attract people. And that is why a lot of people have perception that, okay, this is wildlife. So you have to go to the forest to make certain images. You have to go to safaris to make certain images. But guys, the reason I'm showing all these images, because if you consider this image, this is also a wildlife photography to me. This image, I made this image in our university campus of Surat on one of the, you know, milestones out there. So the point is, a lot of people do not consider these kind of images or this kind of subject as wildlife photography or nature photography. So first of all, I would like you to understand that wildlife is not just what you see during safaris and when you go into deep dark forest, but wildlife is everywhere. You can start seeing wildlife from your balcony. You can start seeing wildlife from your backyard, correct? So wildlife is basically, it is everywhere. It's not just that it is in the forest only. So guys, if you want to get into wildlife photography, nature photography, keep your eyes open, start observing things around you, and you will find a lot of wildlife just out there in your backyard or in your balcony, right? So first of all, we need to change this perception that what is wildlife? It is not just lion, tiger, leopard. It is every element which is existing on this planet without an interference of human is, and it belongs to nature, is wildlife. So wildlife and nature is alive. Nature is a wider gamut than the wildlife, correct? Okay. Even, when you say nature means rocks, river, trees, everything which is there is nature. So I like to use these kind of elements along with wildlife. So I consider myself more like a nature photographer and less like a wildlife photographer, right? So every natural element on this planet, every natural heritage of this planet, which is there on this planet without an interference of human, is called nature. And wildlife is a part of nature, correct? So I consider that I should call myself a nature photographer than just a wildlife photographer, because I like to use a lot of these kind of elements into my images. And not just the object. Okay, so what are the type of nature photographers? You know, there are a lot of different kind of nature photographer that, you know, there are nature photographers, those who play with numbers. They say that I have got 500 birds, I have got 100 mammals in my frame. So these are the people, I guess they have the collective instinct. They play with the numbers, 600 birds and 100 mammals and all those big numbers they want to collect. I call them that they have a collective instinct as a nature and wildlife photographer. Then there are photographers who make images into nature are selective. They are very particular about their images. They are very particular about their subject. So they want particular subject in particular situation. So they're not concerned about what is there around. They're only concentrating on their perception of what do they want. And they have already, you know, perceived it in their mind. They have imagined everything that what kind of image that they want. Correct. So these are the people I call them selective people. They have a very selective criteria to make images into nature and wildlife. But the last species I'm going to talk about is of nature photographers is creative and fine art people. You know, it is the third species, I should say, you know, as nature and wildlife photographers. So today we are going to talk about this third species of nature photographers, right? So when I say that creative and fine art photographers, a lot of people have different kind of perceptions in their mind. And everybody try to elaborate this word, fine art and creativity, you know, whatever the way they want it, right? But guys, for me as a wildlife photographer and as an artist, I try to derive these words, creativity and fine art. So, you know, if I have to take an example of this particular picture, it has so much of content and information both. See this image, when you say a manna sitting in a flood hole on a bridge wall, you can see humans out there on the wall. So it tells you the story of coexistence of wildlife into human areas, correct? It also tells you the story that there are no more trees around the city areas, and thus birds are building the nest into the concrete. So it has got two story. Either it can be perceived as the coexistence of human and wildlife, or you can say the overpowering human who have built these concrete jungles, and there are no more trees left, and birds have to build the nest into the concrete walls. So you can take these kind of things as creative and fine art images, but we will define what is creativity, we will define what is fine art photography. Right. So there's always two things when you see things as photographers, either it is a beauty or it's a reality. So for example, this is a snow leopard image. It's a very, very beautiful picture. It's very creative framing and everything. There's a snow leopard peeping out of the snow fields. And a lot of people like this image as a creative image. So I kind of say that, okay, it's a beautiful image. Even this, which is a top view of a snow leopard crossing a river, is a pretty much creative image, pretty much a beautiful image, you know. And This is an image of an ibex into the snow fields of Himalayas. This is again a beautiful scape which talks about the habitat of these kind of animals, those who are living into this extreme climatic conditions. But the point is, what is reality? The reality is snow leopard eats these ibex. So as a native photographer, we have to make choices that what do we want to present to our viewers. Either it can be beauty, it can be reality, or it can be both together. It depends, you know, because it's nature. Ultimately, you cannot ask whatever you want from nature. You have to take what all that nature has to offer you. So you have to always pick up things. Either you have to go for beauty or reality. The beauty, you know, a lot of people, we know that there's a beautiful deer jumping in a golden light, you know, in the forest area, a beautiful morning. You are going on a safari, you see a beautiful deer baby jumping here and there. And next moment, you see a lion catches the deer baby and eating it. You can see the flesh and blood and everything. Correct. So there's always something called beauty and there's always something called reality. So first of all, we have to see that if I'm a fine art or nature photographer or creative photographer, as a fine art and creative photographer, I would pick up beauty against reality. Correct. Because sometimes when it comes to wildlife, reality is more brutal than, you know, how you have seen it before, because not a lot of people have gone into the deep forest to understand what is the reality of the forest. It is a dark secret of forest that you have to understand sometimes. So I have picked up beauty against reality. That's what my subject is. So now, what are the myths of fine art images? Lot of people think that if you want to make a fine art image, convert them into a black and white image and it will be a fine art image. That's the biggest myth. I have seen a lot of people posting their images on their websites and blogs and social media accounts. Black and white images, they'll post it and then they'll consider, okay, this is black and white image, so this is considered as a fine art image. But that's the biggest myth, guys. Not every black and white image can be considered as fine art image, and you cannot say this is a color image and it is not considered as fine art image. So don't think that black and white images are fine art images. It's absolute myth. Another myth of making fine art images to make them blur. Irrelevance of the requirement of the image. People try to either they blur with the help of a lens, or they blur the image with the help of a shutter speed, or so many other things that you can do a blur image. But with absolute no requirement of making images blur, they make certain images which looks very blur, and then they think that, okay, it is a blur image, I'll convert it to further fine art image. Oh, it is more fine art image. It's very, very great example of fine art image. Either it has to be blur, black and white. So we have to come out of these myths that please somebody undo these lines from my screen. Yeah. So we have to come out of these myths that either images are blur and black and white and they are considered as fine art images. So we need to define that what is fine art images in nature. But for that, first of all, we need to understand that why a lot of people, when it comes to nature and wildlife photographers, are creatively challenged. You know, a lot of people are visually challenged. A lot of people are, you know, they are challenged by their physical conditions. But sometimes when people cannot think creatively, means that they are creatively challenged. But why are we creatively challenged? Why cannot we see certain things with a wider perspective? We don't, because everybody is concerned about the animal, and we do not have a broader vision of seeing things. We do not have a broader vision at perceiving things when it comes to us through the lenses and the camera. Correct. So the reason of being creatively challenged is the step zero which we do not follow, and that is called unlearning. So a lot of people, if you really want to get into fine art, if you really want to get into creativity, we need to unlearn what is there in our mind. And what do we have to unlearn? Say, for example, if somebody is asked to draw a landscape, okay, Priyanshi, can somebody say what kind of landscape people would like to draw? So 90% of the people would draw two mountains. Sun is exactly coming out of the center. The one ray of the sun is larger and another is smaller and then larger and smaller and larger and smaller. So this is basic. The river is coming exactly from the center of the mountain. There are two, three clouds, few trees and a house. That is the only perspective of landscape painting, because that is what every school is nowadays teaching, that if you have to draw a landscape picture, it has to be like this. A lot of people would perceive landscape painting like this. But this is somewhere, this is something where, you know, I don't know why a sun cannot come out of the center of the, you know, mountain. It can come out from anywhere. But everybody is taught to draw a sun from the center of the mountain. So guys, what if somebody has gone to great run of Kutch, where the landscape is like this, white run and a sun. There is nothing else in the scape. But if a child will draw a painting of landscape like this particular image, the teacher will not give him enough good marks. And that threat, that fear of getting less marks, we have suppressed our creativity. And we are doing what everybody else is doing. That is the biggest threat to creativity. That is the biggest threat to fine art people. So if you really want to get into fine art, if you really want to get into creativity, we have to come out of the fear of getting less marks. And nowadays, the point is that we have a fear of getting less likes is the biggest problem. So come out of the fear of getting less marks and come out of the fear of getting less likes on social media. And be fearless, because creativity has to be fearless, and unlearn what you have seen. Unlearn what you can think, and then you need to start your first step. So step zero of getting into creativity and fine art is unlearning what we have been taught. Correct? So I always say people that scrap your first thought. We need to scrap our first thought. You know, a lot of people, suppose if they'll see this beautiful image of the spotted deer crossing a railway line, they would make this beautiful image with a beautiful light. But what I understand is, I guess, if you can see here, there are a lot of elements. There are lines, there are spots, there are beautiful antlers, horns, there are trees, there are a lot of things. So you can pick up one or two things and you can make a different image. So this, if somebody would see this particular scenario, they would want to make these kind of images. But we have to understand that a spotted deer is not a new thing in terms of wildlife photography. Everybody has been capturing spotted deer since years and years and years. So why somebody would make the same image? So first of all, we have to understand that we have to scrap the first thought that comes to our mind when you see the scenario. So I perceive this image like this. And I captured only the horns of this antler, spotted deer, I mean. And if you see this, I can see a Buddha giving blessings. If you can see a hands of Buddha here in this image, correct, it's a different image. So this is the reason that we have to scrap our first thought. We need to learn how you can see things differently, how you can pick up different elements out of the scenario and you see and take it as a different element. And you present it with a metaphor that how we have seen it. So first of all, we have to scrap the first thought when we see the scenario. And we need to think something really very different when it comes to nature and wildlife photography, especially in creativity and fine arts. Correct? So if you think about a lion, a lot of people would want to see lion like this. 5:30 p.m. light and a beautiful male, handsome male lion sitting on a hill and looking into the eyes of sun, and you know, everything which is set up to make a beautiful lion portrait. So if this is the image, everybody who have seen the lion probably can make these kind of images. So what I feel is this is nothing very special. This is that everybody, there's no skill as a photographer. There is no skill as an artist if I want to make this kind of image. All I have to do is I have to be there with the camera, and I'll get this kind of images. So how do I scrap my first thought? So I would rather, we'll make a couple of these kind of images, and then I would make a really very different image, and I would make this image. This is also the same lion sitting on the same place. I just changed my direction. I just try to use the geometry around the animal. I just try to make it more dramatic. I just try to make the use of the graphics which is available around the subject. And this is a different image. And it's not enough that it's just a different image, but it has also a character that this image also talks. This image talks about the overall habitat of this place where lions are living. And this image does not talk about the habitat, but this image certainly talks about the habitat of lion. So, you know, sometimes your images are creative and informative at the same time. Correct. So this is how we have to learn and how we can see things with a different perspective. Right. So step one of making a creative and a fine art image. So step one to of making a fine art image is it has to be unique. Okay. If you see this bird image, this is unique in terms of angle. Not a lot of birds are clicked from, you know, from exactly as an aerial perspective. We have not seen birds from their aerial perspective. So the step one of making a fine art image is you have to make a unique image. So what is, how you can make a unique image? You have to be original. It has to be imaginative. It has to be different. When I'm saying original means it has to be original. If it is something, if it belongs to something, if it looks like something, it has to be just the coincidence, nothing else. It has to have that imagination of photographer, how he can see the scenario with a very different perspective. And third is it has to be different, but it has to be meaningfully different. Always remember that I have seen a lot of artists making some absurd art piece just to become different. You know, do not make a different thing just to become, you know, absurd. Just try to make a different image with some meaning into it. If there is no meaning and you're different, it is just you're trying to be different. You're a wannabe artist. So don't take me other way around. It's okay when you're doing things very differently and stupid things to learn the art of creativity, but don't try to be very different just for the sake of it, right? Your differentness has to have that meaningful impact into your image. So if you want to make unique images, you have to be original, imaginative, and you have to be different, right? So if one or two quality from these three words, original, imaginative, and different, can be attached to your image, your image is a unique image, right? I'm just sharing a couple of these kind of examples with what I have been telling you. So you can just try and, you know, merge what I am trying to tell you through these images. Okay. So step two is it has to be impressive. As I said that you have made a unique image. It means your image is original. Your image is imaginative. It is different. But what if there are no aesthetics? What if it is not beautiful? It means what if it is not impressive? Art has to impress some or other people. It has to impress somebody because art is always incomplete without a viewer. So if you have made a unique image, which is imaginative, which is different, you know, it has to have impressive aesthetics into it. It has to have beautiful things into it so that viewers want to see. It should not be just a different but an ugly image. It cannot be an imaginative but an ugly image. It cannot be a different and you know, ugly image altogether. So it has to have beautiful image. It has to be an aesthetically nice and it has to be deliberate. It should not be a mistake. It's okay. Sometimes you learn from your mistake. But when you make images, when you learn from your mistakes, you need to make the deliberate effort to make these kind of images. So step one is your images has to be unique. And step two is your images has to be impressive. So it has to be unique, but impressive also. Just unique image, which is not impressive, does not make sense to a lot of viewers. And if it does not make sense to viewers, artists cannot say that, hey, I do it for myself, I don't care about viewers. If as an artist, if you don't care about viewers, we have no rights to post it, we have no rights to put it in the gallery. As an artist, if you want to put our work in gallery, if you want to post it, it means we do care about viewers. And if we do care about viewers, we have to understand that it has to be impressive. It has to have the aesthetics that people will stop for a while at your images and will give something, some thoughtful, you know, conversations with you. So step one was unique. Step two is impressive, right? If you see these kind of images, they're beautiful and they have some aesthetical values. Sometimes they are absurd, sometimes they are geometrically nicely arranged. So it just depends, correct? So if you understand step one, unique, step two, impressive, right? Step three is you should enhance the intellectual property of the image. You know, it means your picture is unique, Your picture is beautiful, but your picture must have something to talk about. Your picture must have a story to tell someone. It should be relative to something. It should be meaningful. Very important part of fine art photography, because you cannot make some absurd image and name it fine art. It should be storytelling. It should have some relevance to it. It should be meaningful. You know, it should have something. So step three is you should have an intellectual property. So if you see these two images at first glance, it looks like an abstract pattern of rocks in Himalayas, some ice patches on. But these two images are very interactive. It has an intellectual property because it tells the story of snow leopard, which are highly camouflaged. So guys, can you see snow leopard in this image? If you can see it, you can go to next slide. Can somebody save it? Right? There is a snow leopard here, rightly in the frame, center frame, and here it is just beneath this, this snow patch. Correct. So if your image is unique, if your image is aesthetically well arranged, if your image has a story to tell, if your image is meaningful, you are a step closer to making a fine art images. Correct. So if you see these two images are a little bit of creative in terms of composition and selection of the background. These images are quite different. Correct. But these images have a story to tell you. This flamingo image, where flamingos are flying against a beautiful buildings. This image tells you a story of urbanization. This image tells you the story of how we are going into the natural habitats and birds has to live with the human communities. Correct. So these kind of storytelling images or meaningful or relative images has to be there. So the quality of the image should have that intellectual property. Correct. Then step four is fill and feel the emotional content of the image. So if your image is unique, if your image is aesthetically well arranged, it means it is impressive. If your image is storytelling, and last but not the least, if your image has that emotional content or the philosophical perspective, or your image is expressive or subjective, your image is just there in the list of fine art images. Correct, guys? So if I have to define myself as a fine art photographer, either I should have at least three or four qualities of these, out of these four, like unique, impressive, intellectual, and emotional. If I can involve my viewers emotionally with my images, I'm there. If I can involve them emotionally, I would certainly call my image a fine art image, and it does not matter whether it is black and white or blur or nothing, right? So step four. Now, how you can make an emotional picture? If you take an example of this image, it tells me the story of mother hyena bringing food for the child. To keep the essence of mother, I just avoided posting this particular image where you can see a dead deer, because dead deer and their blood shells and everything will tell me the story of brutality. This will tell me the story of cruelty, the dark truth of the forest. Correct. To keep the motherhood intact, I posted this particular image because this will tell the story that, okay, mother is bringing food for the kids. So this is how we try to bring some emotions out of our images. So if you see this image where a baby monkey is holding a mother with her tiny hands, it is not an image of monkey. Nobody would want to say that this image is the image of monkey. This is the image of mother and child. This is the image of relationship. This is the image of safety that is felt by the child when it is near to the mother. Correct. So when I will post this image, I would never want to post this image as an image of a monkey. This is an image of a motherhood. This is an image of a relationship. So this is the last parameter of fine art image, that your image has to be expressive, philosophical, and it should be subjective. Correct, guys? So if we can follow these four steps, and when I say emotional image, does not mean that it is always a very strong emotion. Sometimes they are funny emotions, sometimes they are literally sad emotions, they are sometimes very calm and composed emotions. So it depends upon the image and the requirement. Emotions can be different. Correct? So I just remember, very easy to remember, that if I want to make a fine art image, I would follow that. First of all, my image has to be unique. Another thing, my image has to be expressive. Another thing is my image has to be impressive. And then my image has to have that emotional content into it. And my image can be considered as fine art image. And then, a lot of people in nature photography, a lot of people in wildlife photography, they talk about the rules. I don't understand that there are literally rules. In art, can we define rules? Of course not. We cannot put the boundaries of rules when we are creating an art piece. So why do I ask people not to follow rules when it comes to photography and nature and art? Because if everybody would follow the rules which are there in the popular books of photography, then every image would look the same. I have seen a lot of people talking about rule of one third. I don't understand rule of one third. It's okay. Sometimes your images look beautiful when the subject is placed in the center. Forget about the breathing space. Forget about the entering the space and leaving the space and all those theories. Sometimes putting your subject into dead center can also make your image look beautiful. So it's okay to break rules when it comes to art, especially fine art. Right? Because break the rules, because as I said previously, that all your creativity has to be very fearless. So if you see the example of this particular image, how many of you can see an elephant bum in this image and a tail of an elephant? Actually, that's a lion sitting on a tree, correct? But I tried to capture, I composed it in a way that I can see an elephant bum and this. The tail of lion looks like it, as if it is an elephant's tail, right?
Yeah.
So I named this image as lion-tailed elephant. Correct? So it tells you the story also, it gives you information also, and it gives you the metaphor also. So sometimes break the rules and let your creativity be very fearless so you can be literally different. So a lot of time that people think that in nature and wildlife photography, subject means the physical property of the frame. But it is not required, it is not necessary that the subject is the physical property which you see in the scenario. Sometimes physical properties are way beyond than what you can see in the picture. Correct? See, a lot of time I ask this question to a lot of my students that what emotions do you get when you see a child is crying? So a lot of people would answer me back that, oh, poor child. We feel sad when child is crying. I said, okay. The reason is everybody would feel sad if a child is crying or a baby is crying. Everybody would feel sad. But what if the baby is crying because it's a newborn baby? Everybody would be happy. Nobody is sad. If newborn baby is crying, everyone is happy. See, we have to understand with this example that the subject is baby and the act is crying. Baby is crying. But baby is crying in what situation? Why he is crying? Why baby is crying? Correct. That situation makes the emotional, that situation actually brings the emotional content. Correct. That emotional content is why it is crying. So when we make images, the subject sometimes is less important, and why it is doing particular act or why it is there in the frame is more important. So for me, what do I click is less important and why do I click is more important. Correct. So, for example, this is a wildebeest. This is an African animal. And every image or the most image of wildebeest, if you see, they are running. So I tried to capture the speed and not the wildebeest. If you see this particular image, I have not tried to capture the wildebeest. I tried to capture the pace. I tried to capture the speed. I tried to capture the character of the animal and not the animal itself. Okay. So sometimes we have to understand that we need to look beyond the physical appearance of the frame. Say, for example, a lot of times I give this example. What if the tree is bent because of the wind? A lot of people would say, if I'll capture a tree literally bent down the ground, a lot of people would say, oh, the poor tree. But that picture is not the picture of the tree. That picture is a picture of the wind. It tells you the story of the wind and not the tree. Okay. So sometimes the physical appearance in the frame is a tree, but it tells you the story of winds. So we have to learn how we can look things beyond the physical appearance in your frame. Right? So subject in fine art nature photography can be these kind of subjects: peace, flow, happiness, calmness, wind, sadness, emptiness, harmony, music, joy, noise, values, pattern, death. So many. There's so many. You can make these kind of subjects in any damn kind of photography. Not in just wildlife and nature, but you can capture love and emotion in street photography. You can capture love in travel photography. You can capture symmetry in street, travel, and documentary photography. You can capture poetries into any contemporary photography, you know. So these kind of subjects, they are not bound to the kind of photography that we are into. These kind of subjects are basically give you the freedom to think the way you want it and not how subject is appearing in your frame. Right? So guys, we have to understand that we don't capture the subject, we capture beyond what we can see in the subject. And that's where the words which I have been telling you repeatedly, imagination, okay, all these things come in picture. Okay. And another thing is that as an artist, I always try to talk about the honesty between the creation and the artist. A lot of time people say that, okay, they make some mistake and those mistakes comes out to be very beautiful, and that's how they learn things. Of course, we learn from our mistakes. But then I always say that as an artist, you have the deliberate attempt. You evolve through your mistakes. You learn through your mistakes. But ultimately, your creation cannot be a mistake. Let it be beautiful. Let it be meaningful. So you have to be very honest when you create something. You have to be honest with what you have been creating. So you have to perceive what you want to capture. You have to understand before you hit the press and the shutter release button. So before you press your shutter release button, you need to have that idea, that content in your mind, that what you are trying to capture. So you always have to have that honesty as an artist when we are trying to create something. Okay, you learn from your mistake is a good thing. You evolve through your mistakes, the best part, right? But your creation, which you're presenting, cannot be just a mistake. Right? So we cannot sell our mistakes and imperfection on the name of creativity. Okay? You have to understand that is a part of learning for sure. But never sell your mistakes. Never try to sell your imperfections. So you give yourself a time, evolve, practice, sharpen your skills and come out as a better artist. Whatever you've learned through your mistake, try to execute it once again with the perfection that which is there, which is offered by the Mother Nature, right? And do not try to sell those mistakes as your creativity, right? So people should like the image irrespective of the subject. A lot of people would want to see lion, tigers, and leopards. But for me, the image of this mosquito is also beautiful. It is as beautiful as I'm seeing a beautiful scenario, it's a beautiful landscape, an animal in a beautiful landscape. So sometimes you need to understand that do not restrict yourself for a particular subject. we can, as I said, that we can capture one subject in different kinds of photography. We have to understand this particular part, that do not be very subjective, okay, and try to portray different subjects to different emotional contents, right? So, for example, if you take this particular example, that this image is not about a bird which is flying. This image talks about the scale. This image talks about the flow. This image talks about the climate. This image talks about Himalayas. This image also talks about the melting snow. But bird becomes the center point for sure. But that center point, which is a bird, is there just to give you the sense of scale and how big this place is, how it looks in this scale. The bird is not there. You don't know what is the size of this waterfall. Correct. So sometimes it is beyond subject. It is beyond, it is not just about the subject, it is more about the habitat. Right? Then a lot of people also talk about creativity has, if you capture the rare animals, you are very creative. Always, please guys, we have to understand that rare animals, of course you can click creative and find out images of rare animals, but it cannot be said it is a great image because just because it is a rare animal. Rather, we should leave these rare animals little free from photographers and researchers, because they really need to have their own environment without an interference of photographers. Correct. And rather than capturing some great and rare animals, we should learn to capture something uncommon from a very common thing. If we have a technical skill set, we can capture a beautiful image. But if we are emotionally well balanced, if we can see things very differently, you can really make a fine art image. Correct? So sometimes uncommon things in common from the common subject is also more as powerful as something which is very rare, like a snow leopard in Himalayas. So we should follow simplicity than the complexity. Correct. Simplicity is the class. I've seen people unnecessarily trying to complex their images with a lot of objects, with a lot of activities. Just try to capture. You know, there's the best part of photography is you can see what you want to see through your lens. Today, we have a technology which is available that you can see a lot of different things through your subjects. Try to see things what you want to see, but keep it simple. You know, I always say people that, you know, if you can elaborate an essay with two lines, let it be two lines. You don't need 1,000 words. So just make it simple. Just give a statement with your images and do not try to complicate your images. Correct? So guys, if you have any questions or something, I've been talking from last 50 minutes and I'm there. So you guys can come online and we can have a little bit of conversation, right? A conversation, sorry. So hi Priyanshi, can you moderate it for?
Yes, sir. So far we do not have any questions, but people, like participants can unmute their audio and please go ahead and ask.
Good evening, sir.
Yep. Good evening.
Margie Desai.
Yeah, Margie.
So I had this question that for creating fine art images, do we need post-processing? Like, is it necessary?
See, there's a very thin line between editing and post-processing. Okay, there's a very thin line. So we have to understand that post-processing is required to achieve true colors. But you cannot achieve fine art image through post-processing. You have to capture that. You can enhance the beauty. Okay, you can enhance the truthness. Because you know it is very important that the image, when it comes to wildlife and nature, we cannot misguide people through processing. So that truthfulness should be intact in your images. Your images should have that true value of nature. That images should have, you know, that people should believe in your pictures. There's a reason that a lot of, say for example, Margi, you can unmute Margi so you can react.
Yes, okay.
Sir. So, you know, there's a reason people believe in pictures. You know, if somebody has to give a proof in the, you know, what we see in pictures, do we give the submit paintings or photographs as a proof?
Is
valid? Painting can be valid or not as a proof of something?
No, sir.
No, correct. It is not valid. Because people believe in pictures. People sometimes cannot believe in paintings. Of course, painting is a great form of art and the most popular form of art, I must say. Correct. But people would still believe in photographs and they will believe less in paintings when it comes to proof and it comes to truthness. Correct. So when it comes to truthfulness, people believe in pictures, and I don't want, you know, that there will be an era that people will stop believing pictures also because of post-processing.
Yes,
so we must stay away from this virus called post-processing. Make good images through your optics. Correct. Make thoughtful images through your optics. You can little bit enhance your color to achieve. You can little bit, you can achieve your true colors through post-processing. That's it. Otherwise, we cannot modify the images. We cannot include or exclude unwanted subjects in the frame. Correct? And we have to understand that people should believe in photographs. And if this post-processing virus will be, you know, it is going to be more fatal for photographers. So guys, stay away from post-processing and try to make pictures through your optics.
Okay. Thank you, sir. I'm a huge fan.
There is a question in the comments section by Yurukaya. She's asking, whose work has influenced you the most?
Okay. See, it is not one particular person. Okay. I cannot pronounce your name, but yeah. okay. So the thing is that I cannot take one particular name that, okay, I like this particular photographer. But I like a lot of photographers, some 5-4 names I should take. So I like Ganesh Shankar as a fine art photographer. I like Nick Brand. I like Amy Vitale. I like, so many photographers, but I like Jan Sharma also for that reason. I like Snehal Patel also for that reason. I like this Joy Lawrence also. I like, so there are a lot of photographers I like Art Wolf for that matter. Correct. So there are a lot of photographers whose work I like. So it is not, influence is not there. I cannot say it is influence, but I do inspire seeing their work that yes, I should also make an image which can leave an impact on my viewers the way I am getting affected with the images that I have been watching. Correct. So I'm influenced to make good image. I'm inspired to make good images. I'm inspired to make create a great piece of art. But I'm not very influenced by their work, but I do follow their work. And even every artist, we have to understand that it is very important ki whom do you follow. Nowadays, I always say that there's something called visual pollution because of social media. On social media, we follow random people, very, very random people. Correct. And because of that, that random followership and all, we get to see a lot of visual pollution. So stay away from those visual pollution. Select your people you are following on different platforms very carefully so that whatever you see is a good piece of art and it's not a scrap of art which is a visual pollution to your mind and your soul. Okay, so stay away from it. Get influenced, get inspired from correct set of people. Do not go with the numbers. Say, for example, if I have to take Ganesh Shankar, he has only 500 followers on Instagram, but he's a great photographer. Correct? But the whole younger generation is actually falling for number. They want numbers. They're following, they say that, okay, him or her, I cannot take names, but him or her is a great photographer because they have 1 million followers. That's bullshit. You can buy these followers. Correct? So always remember that it's a very important key up. To whom you should follow. So pick up those, your inspirations very carefully so that you come up as a nice artist, you come up with a different vision, not which already have been done by the other, a lot of people have been doing great things and you should not become one of them. And you really come out as a very, you come out with your statement, you come out with your language and your grammar. Through your pictures is most important, right? I hope, yeah. Anything else?
So I have a question. So so the one of your images that had centipede on yellow and white wall. So it reminds me of this dialogue I had with this person who said that phone photography is a lazy kind of photography. So I didn't understand at that point because obviously cameras are not accessible when you want to capture certain frames because of the time and things you are carrying at that particular time. So what are your thoughts about on this?
See, first of all, we have to accept that a camera is a camera is a camera. We cannot avoid the fact that everything that can capture an image is a camera. Whether it is in phone, whether it is a digital SLR, whether it is a film roll camera, whether it's a pinhole camera, it doesn't matter. Anything that can capture an image is a camera. Correct. So we have to accept that mobile phone, which can capture a camera, which can capture an image, is a camera. Correct. So I don't think so. It is a lazy approach of making an image. I would say rather making a good image through your mobile phone camera is again further challenging. Correct. But the only drawback of certain thing is that you cannot make it, you cannot print it large.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's the drawback of that particular thing. When you take a picture through your mobile phone, you cannot print them very large. I'm fond of making large prints, so I always carry my camera along with me. Okay. So it's good to capture your images through your SLR. But if you do not have it, and if you see something beautiful around you, which you need to capture, you should capture with your phone. There's nothing wrong. Correct? Yeah. It is a camera. And we have to appreciate if somebody is making good images through their phone. But the only worry, or the only thing which gives me this worry is that I believe that you should print our pictures. When it comes to printing, the images which is taken through mobile phones doesn't give you good printing results. Otherwise, I don't mind people taking images through their mobile phone.
Okay, so sir, do you think like all the prints has to be like large in size? Or like even if it's a phone photography, they can be like small tiny pictures of 4 into 6 inches or something.
Absolutely. See, we don't need to have the large print like 72 inch and 65 inch and all. Okay. Yeah. Every image belongs to particular size. Okay. We have to understand that every image needs a particular frame size. Yeah. If I have to give you an example of my own exhibition. Okay. Yeah. So in my exhibition, there were prints were just 8 inches. And there were prints 82 inches. Okay. So when you require a smaller size of frame, you know, every image calls for a particular frame size, according to me. There are certain images which looks great on a big print. There are certain images which looks very nice. They make a very pretty, you know, that they can convert your wall into an art piece, although it is just an 8-inch print.
Yeah.
Okay. So it does not matter that you should print large, but even for that 8-inch print, the print quality should be very beautiful. And not a lot of photographers nowadays are going for printing. People are not very conscious about printing because ever since it has gone digital, people are getting away from the printing things. People are getting away from the exhibitions because of social media. Everything that they want to see is there on the social media. But I don't like to see things only on this 4x6 mobile phone screen. I like to see things on a larger screen or a large print. Okay. Yeah. Let it be a small print, but the print would always justify the quality of the image. Okay. So it doesn't matter if it's a small print or big print. It depends upon the requirement of the frame.
Yeah, true, sir. Thank you. So there's another question by Realme 7 Pro. This person is saying, good evening, sir. As nowadays beginners in the field of photography, user always want to jump onto the DSLR rather than actual understanding of photography field. People purchase costly equipments just to get good images. So is that worthy? Or people should first understand photography, their interest by going through mobile photography, then point and shoot camera and then DSLR?
He has asked a question, he has answered itself. So the point is, yes, nowadays, a lot of people think that if they'll buy a costly equipment, they'll be able to make some good images. It is not right. It is something. Camera is just a tool. You can enjoy the scenario which is there in front of you. Okay, camera is just a tool. It is something like that, if I'll give you a beautiful pen, you cannot write a great poetry. Okay. It is just like the camera plays a role like a pen for a poet. Okay. So it's just a pen for a poet. So it does not matter whether you have a great SLR camera or a beginner level SLR camera or mobile phone camera. Correct. But yes, of course, we should start gradually. So if somebody wants to learn a car, how to drive a car, they will not go and buy Mercedes. Okay. They will just go and buy a small car. They will learn how to drive it. And then gradually they'll upgrade that. So that is the process. So rather than buying costly equipments, I would suggest as a wildlife and nature photographer that we should spend more on our expeditions and traveling than the camera. Correct. So that will give you more opportunity to make some great images. Okay, so do not be the slave of your equipment. Do not become a slave of your equipment and obey what camera is asking you to click you. Okay. Try to get the command of your equipment. You can create wonderful images through your mobile phone and you can create some piece of scrap through SLR. So both ways it is implied. I mean, you can take it how you want it. Okay, so do not. And another thing is that never think that somebody is a great photographer because he has a great camera. Okay, and don't even judge people. You know, we always say that, okay, don't judge a book by the cover. So don't judge people by their equipment. That sometimes I've seen some beginner photographers, they're creating wonderful images with the very, very entry-level cameras. And I've seen some great photographers making really bad images with a very costly equipment. So it doesn't matter. It's just a pen for a poet. Okay?
Yeah. So I have another question. So one thing you wish you knew before you took photography as a profession?
I should know the business part of photography. I should have been, you know, introduced to business part of photography, because business part of photography, or for that matter, any kind of art is a risky affair. Okay, so I guess I should have been more aware about the business part of it. But okay, I've been struggling and I'm not worried. I'm just trying my level best to get into it. But yeah, I think I should be more aware about how I can earn money out of that. Because sometimes people are not, there's some great artists, but they don't know how to sell themselves, or they don't know how to sell their work. Yeah. So they are suffering, and there are some artists, they probably are not great artists, or they are not the best artists probably, but they know how to sell their work and they become very popular and they can live whatever, they can earn whatever they want out of their art. Yeah. Correct. So actually, I should have known the professional part of an art.
Okay, makes sense. It's from Vineet Kavani. Please share your experience about your ongoing documentary which you were shooting near Rajasthan.
Yeah. Hi, Vineet. I'm glad that you know that I was shooting in Rajasthan.
Yes, sir. You posted it on Instagram.
By any chance, are you from Rajasthan?
No, I am from Surendranagar.
Surendranagar. Okay, so
yes, I talk about Nirav Bhatt sir also a times.
He's a very good friend to me. Okay, so I was, sometimes in wildlife and nature, we are shooting a very different kind of subjects. So I was given an assignment by the Forest Department of Gujarat to shoot different kind of grass in Gujarat.
Okay.
So I was shooting, tame Gujarati chho ne?
Haan haan, Gujarati chho.
Saurashtra ni video shoot karta to badi. VD, jay rehen na apne ke, VD ma gya tha.
Achha, to tame VD ma gya tha, chotila ni pachad ni.
Yes.
I was... okay. So... Bahu sari jagya chha hai. Recently, hu pan ni aagyo to. As you know, ke honey badgers ni a chowa maade chatle meni maate.
So I was not shooting birds, I was not shooting mammals and anything. I was shooting grass because, there is the grass has its own life cycle. That gives sheets. The sheets are shaded out of them, and then the grass basically are taken away from these grasslands and they are stored and processed. Okay. So I was supposed to capture the grass and the seeds and how the process is carried away and everything is there. So I was actually shooting grass, nothing.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Thank you so much, sir, for this insightful session, and thank you so much for doing this for Art and Artisans. And we will be uploading this whole session on YouTube soon. So if you want to get notified, please subscribe to Art and Artisans YouTube channel. Please follow Saurabh. So, I mean, I'm pretty much sure like you guys will be following him and his works. But if you want to know more about his journey and everything, please visit his website. It's really beautiful. Please do. I put links in the chat box. So all the useful links are on the chat box. So please visit. And thank you so much, sir, for this session.
Thank you.
It was a great
time.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
Okay.
Okay. Bye.